Good afternoon and welcome to the 11th annual Sacred Trust Talks and book signing event presented by the Gettysburg Foundation and the Gettysburg National Military Park. The Gettysburg Foundation, the nonprofit partner of the National Park Service at Gettysburg, is pleased to collaborate with Gettysburg National Military Park to invite renowned Civil War historians, authors, National Park Service rangers, licensed battlefield guides, and experts to this program each year to share their unique perspectives on the Battle of Gettysburg and the American Civil War with our visitors. Our final speaker this afternoon is Mr. William, better known as Jack, Davis, who will discuss Grant and Lee, the generals nobody knows. He will look at the men behind the blue and gray uniforms, examining aspects of their characters and personalities often overlooked or ignored. Mr. Davis is the author or editor of more than 50 books in the fields of Civil War and Southern history, as well as numerous documentary screenplays. He was the on-camera senior consultant for 52 episodes of the Arts and Entertainment Network History Channel series Civil War Journal, as well as a number of other productions on commercial and public television and for the BBC, and has acted as historical consultant for several television and film productions. In September of 2013, he retired after 13 years as professor of history and executive director of the Virginia Center for Civil War Studies at Virginia Tech in Blacksburg. He is a four-time winner of the Jefferson Davis Award given for book-length works in Confederate history. His book, Crucible of Command, Ulysses S. Grant and Robert E. Lee, The War They Fought and the Peace They Forged, has been published, and his book, The Battle of New Market, provided the basis of the motion picture Field of Lost Shoes, which was released in 2014. He is a member of the advisory board of the Abraham Lincoln Bicentennial Commission and serves on several other consultative bodies, as well as being an occasional consultant to the Virginia State Police on cold case homicides. At this time, let us please welcome Mr. Jack Davis.
Good afternoon. You know, for 31 years, I lived about 25 miles north of here in Mechanicsburg, and I cannot remember a battle weekend anniversary that was as cool as this one is. You know, usually it's about 98 degrees, and this can't be more than 93, 94. It's really quite pleasant. It's kind of you all to show up to share a part of your weekend with the people who are speaking up here. It is great for you all to show up and support this park and the wonderful work of the National Park Service. Just let me double check. Are you able to hear back there? Can you hear okay? Anybody else? Okay, you can hear back there. You can't. I'll try to talk right into this if that helps. You're not going to miss anything. See, he heard that. They asked me to talk with you a bit today about this book that recently came out, A Crucible of Command, U.S. Grant, Robert E. Lee, their lives, the war they fought, and the peace they forged, and that's what I'm going to do for the next 2 or 3 hours. It's not really a biography or a dual biography. It's really much more a look, I think my goal was, a look inside these men, to try to figure out what made them take, what composed their ethical and moral compasses, what created the personalities and the characters, what made them on the inside the kind of men who made the decisions they made when the time came on the outside. And I'll share a little something with you that not a lot of people know, which is that I have a direct connection to U.S. Grant. Now, we're not related. I'm taller than he was. I'm proud of that. Back in the 1960s, I grew up as a military brat. My grandfather was a brigadier in the old quartermaster corps. And in retirement, he almost bought a house in Escondido, California, for Major Chapman Root Grant, who was U.S. Grant's youngest surviving grandson. They didn't buy the house, but my grandmother, as her grandson's most ardent promoter, asked Colonel Grant, Major Grant, if he would be willing to share a little time with this grandson of hers, who was then about 15, to meet. Growing up in California, there wasn't a whole lot of Civil War around, if you were interested. So I got to meet him, and in fact, a friendship developed between us that lasted for about 20 years until his death. He had a wonderful home, a mission-style house in the middle of an orange grove on top of a low hill just outside Escondido. A marvelous man. He'd been a major in the old U.S. Army. He was in the U.S. Cavalry with Black Jack Pershing and the incursion into Mexico against Pancho Villa in 1913, I think it was. After that, he was a pioneer herpetologist. That's not the study of herpes, which can be interesting, I'm told. He study of reptiles, and he was a real pioneer at this. In his elder years, he almost was completely blind. He had just peripheral vision, probably macular degeneration, I would guess. And this man who had read voraciously, who had written books himself, could no longer see to read if he tried to watch television. He had to look this way with the screen right here, and he could see a few shadows and moving images. That was about it. So the quid pro quo that developed between us was that I would come and read to him aloud when I went to Southern California to visit. And in turn, he would turn me loose in this house that was full of memorabilia from his grandfather, General and President U.S. Grant. If we ate lunch, it was off of Grant's White House china. He had a whole bureau full of White House china. On the wall was an autographed photograph from Abraham Lincoln, one of those profiles taken in 1863, given to Grant by Lincoln. There was a presentation sword from somebody or other, presentation pistols that were engraved, given to Grant by Samuel Colt, supposedly a peace pipe given to Grant by Sitting Bull. If so, he wasn't serious, as Custer found out. Bits of uniforms, letters, the day book, the adjutant's book of the 4th U.S. Infantry when Grant was temporarily adjutant in the 1850s out in the West Coast. Marvelous stuff. And picture yourself in the 1960s as a 15, 16, 17-year-old boy really interested in the Civil War, trapped on the West Coast while the centennial is going on back here, to have that kind of direct contact with someone who's just two generations removed from one of the greats, not just in the Civil War pantheon, but in the American pantheon as well. It had a profound effect, I think, on my life in steering me in the direction I went. It almost did not, because I did eat off that White House china from time to time. Now, like all sane people, I loathe cheese. Why anybody with a functioning cerebellum would want to eat a congealed mass of bovine glandular excretion? I mean, why not just eat a bucket full of cholesterol? You know, or eat a shell no pest strip. They all look about the same. Well, Major Grant made lunch for us one day, and it was a cheese and tomato sandwich. A slab of this cheese, the aforementioned cheese, on some kind of bread. I think it was called salt rising or salt risen bread. The damn bread tasted like cheese as well, with a tomato on it. And then we sat down at this dining table. The table, by the way, had belonged to the Grants as well, though it was not from the White House. And I'm to eat this lunch in front of my host. And what do you do when you do not want to offend your host? Parenthetically, I've been offending hosts all my life by not eating the cheese they put in front of me, and the damn people still do it. But then I realized, he's blind. As long as I kept him looking straight at me, I knew that his peripheral vision would not pick up what I was doing. I got the tomato down my neck. That was not a problem. But I was stuck with this cheesy bread and this enormously thick slab of paving material. And then I remembered, aha, he also has a little dog. Some kind of little terrier that was hanging around the table. So I would break the bread up into quarters. The dog would eat the bread. But even the dog was smart enough not to eat the cheese. But if I distracted Major Grant long enough, I'd say, you know, there's Elvis or something like that. I'd break the cheese into quarters, hand it to the dog, and the dog would go, But if I said, oh, and there's Marilyn Monroe, too, I'd pick up the cheese, and on the second presentation, the dog would eat the cheese. So there's my U.S. Grant story. I didn't know Grant himself, but I once had lunch with his grandson's dog. Marvelous man, Major Grant. I often think of titling a talk like this, Grant and Lee, the generals nobody knows, because so much of what Americans believe they know about both men, in fact, turns out to be largely mythology. You know, myth isn't just something that happened to the ancient Greeks and the ancient Romans. It's all around us all the time. We all participate in it by passing on stories. We all create myths. Myths are always remind me sort of like the funhouse mirrors. If you go to a carnival, you stand in front of it. I like the mirrors that make me 6'6" and about 160 pounds. You know, the basic image is genuine, but it's been grossly misshapen by the mirror. And that is what mythology tends to do. And it has certainly done that with Lee and with Grant. A few examples of some of the fairly commonly known things about Lee and Grant. I'll start with Lee. Lee was opposed to slavery. He did not believe in slavery. False. He had no interest in slavery because, as a serving Army officer, he had no use for slaves. There is no evidence that Lee ever bought a slave, though he was thinking of buying one in 1860 when he was in Texas with the 2nd Cavalry because he could not hire a white manservant. So the next best thing would have been to buy a slave. He didn't. Lee never freed slaves either, and of his own. I'll get to that a little bit later. Lee essentially is indifferent to it. He thinks it's an evil, but it's something man can do nothing about. Only God can deal with slavery. So what is the message there? Since nothing happens on earth unless men, as God's agents, make it happen, slavery is going to be perpetual. What's another myth about Lee? That he never hated the Yankees. He never called them the enemy. It was always those people. This one boggles the mind because all you have to do is read any of Lee's reports or his wartime letters, and they're the enemy constantly, and that's when he's being nice. They are vile Yankees. They're a disgrace to the human race. By 1863, Lee has, I think, genuinely come to hate the Yankees and almost to regard them as a separate and inferior race because of what he sees them doing to the South, and especially because of the breakup in his own family, the loss of his personal fortunes, which were never much to begin with, what he sees happening to Virginia. He regards all of this as the result of malicious Yankeeism. He has no use for them, whatever. Gettysburg is Lee's only great defeat. Well, it's not if you look at what he intended to do when he come here, when he came here. I'm sorry, I live in Virginia, so I'm altering my verbs now. Lee did, think about this. People will say, well, he was driven back in defeat, had to go back to Virginia, so the campaign was a defeat. Do you think he came here to stay? I mean, the Confederacy was really not trying to, you know, annex the Amish. The reason for coming here is not to conquer Pennsylvania. He's very explicit about what his goals were. His goals were to lure the Union Army out of Virginia, which he did. It was to give Virginia a respite in that summer of 1863, time for crops to grow, to be harvested, to relieve the pressure on the people, which he did. The Yankee Army is not in deep Virginia again for the rest of the year. Ideally, also, it was in the hope of delivering a heavy blow in the north, a.k.a. a northern defeat, that might have an influence in the fall elections. There were some, on those days, some off-term elections, an odd-numbered years for some congressional seats and a number of governorships and legislatures. Only in that did the campaign fail. He achieved two of his three main goals. Actually, three of the four main goals, because the other one was to scare the bejesus out of the North, which is what he did. To relieve the pressure on Vicksburg, which almost took place. Gettysburg is not a defeat. It's a battle that he did not win, but if he had won it, what was he going to do? Turn right around and go back to Virginia anyhow. His artillery ammunition is exhausted. His army is badly battered. It's lost more than a third of its officer corps. He was never going to stay in Pennsylvania indefinitely. So this notion of somehow or other, there's a small but loud lobby of people who would criticize Lee for this foolish invasion and for this badly managed battle. And the battle was not well managed. But the fact is, he achieved most of what he set out to do. And in fact, you will find some of the Southern press, especially in Richmond, regarding this as a qualified victory, because so much had been achieved. Another myth about Lee is that after the war, he's a champion of reconciliation. He's not. He does comport himself much better than many other ex-Confederates who immediately start fighting battles amongst themselves as to who was responsible for losing the war, all of which essentially came down to he did it. Everybody else turned and ran, but I didn't and my men didn't. Or to trying essentially to ignore the result of the war. I think John Marsalek spoke parenthetically about this just before me. And to kind of reclaim control of the southern states and to pretend the war had never happened and to go on as usual. Lee's not part of that crowd either. His advice to everyone is to go home and rebuild yourself. Give your parole. Lay down your arms. Try to be a good citizen. Try to be a good citizen in your community and your county and your state. Help in the rebuilding. But that's as far as it went. Lee will never speak out in favor of a big, warm, fuzzy hug between North and South after the war. Interestingly enough, Lee's a very proud American up to 1861. After 1865, you will never again find him referring to himself as an American. He is a Southerner or a Virginian. His view of the nature of things in the reunited nation from 1865 until his death in 1870 is that this is a union held together by force without the consent of half of the governed. That's not an attitude of reconciliation. Lee carries some bitterness with him. To his credit, he carries it within him rather than going on the public stand to proclaim it outwardly. He tries to make of himself an example for others to follow, not of willing acceptance of the result of the war, but of acquiescence in the inevitable. There's a big difference. There are wonderful myths about Lee. Don't worry, I'm going to get to the Grant myths too. But there are more myths, there are more about Lee, and I'll share with you an interesting facet of myths, and especially in this instance. The myths about Lee are almost all favorable. They portray Lee in a favorable light. Lee the magnanimous. Lee the man who can't hate. Lee the generous. Lee the reconciliator. Almost all of the myths about Grant are negative. And I'll get to some of them after a while. Why is that? It largely grows out of the Lost Cause myth, which was consciously created largely by Jubal Early and a number of other Confederate generals after the war, by which, having lost the war, they won the peace by winning history. And they're still winning, they're still winning it today, because so many Americans prefer to believe the myth rather than face up to some of the reality. The problem is, if you start debunking these myths, you wind up sounding like someone who's anti-Lee and pro-Grant. And you can see why. That's not the case. I would like to think I'm essentially even-handed toward both of them. I never got to have lunch with Lee's grandson's dog, so I might be biased slightly either toward Grant or toward small wire-haired terriers that eat cheese. But I'm not. And we'll get to some Grant myth. Really, to show you an example of how myth works and how we choose to blindly accept them sometimes. Some of you will probably have heard the story of an event that supposedly took place in Richmond. On June 4th, 1865, Lee has surrendered. He's come back to Richmond. and he attends a communion service at his church, St. Paul's, in Richmond. When it's time for communion, so goes the story, and it's been widely published, the first person to get to the communion rail is not any of the white members of the congregation, but a black man who has gotten there first somehow, and the rest of the congregation is stunned and shocked. What do we do? Well, the way the story is often presented is that Lee got up and went and stood next to this man at the communion rail and took communion with him as kind of a sign of coming together, of the universal brotherhood under God that exceeds and goes far beyond distinctions of color and race. And that was a signal to the rest of the congregation to come forward and take communion. But when that story first appeared in 1908, this is 40 years after the fact, it is, in fact, presented as an example of Lee refusing to be intimidated by the effrontery of this black man who had the gall to try to take communion before the whites. And, of course, Lee never says anything about this because I'm convinced this episode never took place. But it's in one book after another, so it must be true, right? But stop and think about it. Anybody here ever been to St. Paul's in Richmond? Okay. Anybody ever been to any old church that had a balcony in the back? If it predated the Civil War, probably the black people sat in the balcony. Now answer me, unless he was Jesse Owens, how did this one black man get from that balcony down the back stair and race forward to the communion rail before one white person stood up? It's just nonsense. But it not only has been believed, but it's been twisted and reformed into a pleasing shape to make a hero of Lee. And Lee doesn't need myth to be a hero. As I said, probably the whole episode is sheer fantasy. What were his real feelings toward blacks after the war? He advised Southerners to work hard. If they needed it, he advised Southerners to hire labor. But they should only hire white labor, not black labor. He really did not much care what was going to happen to the free slaves. They had their freedom, but he was looking out for white Southerners. Another myth that's really only come to my attention in about the last 20 years, I would love to know where it began, and this is one that involves both Lee and Grant in the issue of slavery. And some of you may have heard this. In short form, it goes, if the war was about slavery, why is it that Lee freed all of his slaves before the war started, while Grant kept his slaves for years after the war began? Have any of you heard that? It's very popular. You'll find it on lots of blogs and websites and whatever else those things are called, mostly geared around demonstrating that slavery had nothing whatever to do with secession and with the Civil War or with anything else. It was really essentially pretty unimportant, and the slaves were happy being slaves. Well, the hidden message, of course, is that if Lee frees his slaves, then he's not fighting for slavery. If Grant keeps his slaves, then he's not fighting for freedom. They're both myths. Lee, as I said, never bought a slave. There's not one ounce of evidence that he ever purchased a slave. He inherited six in the 1830s when his mother died. He never kept them with him. He didn't need them. He's an army officer serving out on frontiers. He hired them out. He received about $50 a year for the hired labor of each of these slaves. In 1846, when he made out his will before he went off to the war with Mexico, he did in his will provide that in the event of his death, they should be freed, wait for it, when convenient to all parties concerned. Well, I can guarantee you it's pretty convenient to the slaves to be freed right away if he died. But if it wasn't convenient to Lee's widow and his children, the will is meaningless. They could have remained slaves indefinitely. And that is it for Lee's involvement with slaves of his own. He did free slaves. His wife, Mary Custis Lee, inherited, his father-in-law, George Washington Parke Custis, owned a couple of hundred slaves on four plantations in Virginia, and he provided in his will that they should be freed up to 5 years after his death. Lee was executor of his father-in-law's will. His father-in-law died in 1857, and in 1862, 5 years and a few months later, Lee did oversee, right near the Battle of Fredericksburg, oversee the manumission of all of his father-in-law's slaves. But he's not freeing anybody who belonged to him. He's carrying out an obligation. And Grant and his slaves? Did you know that Grant did actually own one slave? There's no evidence that he bought it. The man's name was William Jones. This is when Grant was a farmer at a little farm he called Hardscrabble outside St. Louis. And it was aptly named. He never made anything from it. Near as we can tell, the farm was given to the Grant family by his father-in-law, Frederick Dent, and the slave William Jones came along with the farm. Grant didn't buy him. Grant couldn't afford to buy a slave. He worked out in the fields planting potatoes alongside William Jones, but when the farm failed and he took a job in town, he no longer had need of a slave. He could have sold Jones, even in the Depression of 1857 and 58, he could have sold Jones for several hundred dollars. A prime field hand could bring up to $1,000 or more. Grant desperately needed the money. But instead, he freed him. We don't know why, because Grant otherwise is almost completely silent about any feelings toward slaves or slavery prior to the war. But clearly, he's not all that pro-slave if he freed the man outright. And that's the only slave he ever owned. There were slaves around the Grant family up until 1863, but they were his father-in-law's slaves. Grant no more had the power to free them than Lee had the power to free his father-in-law's slaves had he not been executor of the will. But somehow this myth gets churned and re-churned to try to turn the attitudes of these men towards slavery upside down. And that is largely how myth works. Well, how about a good Grant myth? Do I really have to ask you what the most prominent Grant myth is? Yeah, he's a drinker. He's a lush. That he was a drunkard, if not an alcoholic, both before and during the war. Well, so what? Everybody likes a little toddy now and then. It's nonsense. It's complete nonsense. Grant, there are classic, I think it's the AMA says that something on the order of 6 out of every 100 people is an alcoholic. You know who you are. There are classic signs of alcoholism. They manifest themselves not just behaviorally, but physically, psychologically. Grant manifests not one symptom of alcoholism. His body does not waste away. He's not losing his teeth. He doesn't lose friends. It doesn't interfere with his family relationships. It does not interfere with him professionally. He is a cheap drunk. He's simply one of those people like Bob Toombs of Georgia who did not assimilate alcohol or metabolize it very well. The result being that a couple of drinks could get Grant a little silly. And now and then he would have more than a couple of drinks. There are about 4 documented occasions during the war when Grant did have too much to drink and he tied one on. And they're pretty well documented. But he could go to bed and get up the next morning with no hangover and go right back to work and work his usual 16 to 20 hour days. He could take one drink and have no more. He could go months without having a drink. He could have a social glass of wine, or he might just prefer a bottle of ginger beer. That's a non-alcoholic, sort of like a soft drink. He is not an alcoholic. All the business about Grant being a drunkard starts in 1862 when people who are jealous of his position, his rising position in the Army out in the West, decide to try to find a way to cut him down to size. Near as I can tell, the one who's principally responsible is a steamboat captain named William Kuntz, K-O-U-N-T-Z. Sounds like a good Pennsylvania name. Well, Kuntz was high-handed, arrogant. He's the fellow who sort of showed up in someone else's command area and started doing things without getting the permission of the local commander. Well, you didn't do that with Grant. Grant is a man who is not afraid of confrontation. As soon as he learned about this, Grant had him arrested. You know, you did not have the courtesy to come to my headquarters to let me know you are here, regardless of what business you're on, and now you're ordering steamboats around and steamboat captains and crews, and that is my domain, Mr. Kuntz, and not yours. Well, Kuntz took offense at this and began, when he got out of prison, out of jail, to start to spread stories about Grant drinking. Kuntz then became a protege of one of the perennial bad boys, the great Satan of the Union Army, Brigadier General John McClernand of Illinois, one of these famous political generals, an Illinois congressman who got appointed to a generalship because of his political influence. And McClernand thought he ought to be in charge instead of Grant. I mean, after all, McClernand had been a politician. Grant had merely been a career soldier. McClernand's group of associates grows to include several other division commanders in the army that's being built under Grant, all of them Illinois politicians. Grant and William T. Sherman are the only professional soldiers in high command. And all of them wish they were in command instead of Grant. And McClernand wants to be president. Well, Mr. Kuntz and his rumors are a very handy vehicle. And so he becomes essentially a part of McClernand's retinue, along with a couple of newspapermen. And as you all know, anything that's published in the newspapers must be true. And all of a sudden, these articles start appearing in the anti-Lincoln press about Grant the drunkard, Grant the drinker. Some of them are wonderful. My favorite is one in which Kuntz has Grant falling off a steamboat into the river. Or the other one is Grant's in a St. Louis hotel so drunk that to get to his room, he crawls up the staircase on his hands and knees, kind of like a crab going sideways. And then when he gets to that floor level, he goes knocking from one door to another trying to find a prostitute. Again, so this is all nonsense. But it really took hold in the Democratic press, the anti-administration press. And it really took hold in the American psyche for some reason. And once the war is over and the lost cause myth is in the process of being created, it's really handy for people like Jubal Early and others who are looking for ways to explain how it was that our cause was right and God was on our side, but still we lost. And the way the thinking goes, it's wonderful thinking, is that, well, we lost because the Yankees didn't play fair. They had more men than we did. And they weren't really gentlemen anyhow. I mean, they're led by this drunkard, Grant. Therefore, we really didn't lose in a fair fight. We were overpowered by overwhelming numbers and Grant's breath. To the end, one of the interesting things that Chapman Grant had, you know, Mark Twain was an inveterate inventor, a really sort of Rube Goldberg type stuff. He lost fortunes in the inventions he backed. He essentially invented post-it notes, you know, the yellow sticky things that you all use. Anybody who's ever left the job, the last thing you've done is you've gone to the supply room and cleaned it out of paper clips and post-it notes. I've got dozens and dozens of stacks of these things at home. Twain came up with the Mark Twain scrapbook, which did not require glue. It didn't require those little self-adhesive corners to go around photos. It had essentially what Monsanto puts on the back of a post-it note in strips across the pages. You just took whatever you wanted to save, and you slapped it down on the page, and it stayed there. Major Grant still had U.S. Grant's Mark Twain scrapbook. Pasted into it were the last notes that Grant wrote to his wife, Julia. You know, he had throat cancer. He died of throat cancer. He lost his voice in the last days of his life. And so he had to communicate with Julia by writing her notes. And very frequently, these notes are such things as, please send up a bottle of porter. Porter is kind of a dark beer. What do you think if he had a drinking problem, the one who would know about it would be his wife? Would she encourage it? Of course not. But that myth will never go away. There's the myth that Grant was a failure before the war. And in many ways, he was. But what's interesting is looking behind the failure. You know, he's in the war with Mexico. He then gets sent to the Pacific Coast and spends about 4 years there, where he is not happy. because he's isolated by a continent from his wife, Julia, whom he loved more than anything on earth. That is one of the greatest marriages that certainly at least the White House has ever seen. They simply adored each other. He didn't give a damn what she did. It was okay with him. No matter how down he was when it came to money, if she wanted to spend something, if he had it, he'd say, go ahead. She was his touchstone. I see a wife patting her husband on the knee saying, this is how you should behave with me. Good luck, honey. But trust me, the way to get him to do that is not with a picture of Longstreet on your chest. Well, maybe Longstreet does it for you. He never affected me that way. Exactly. Or some of a bunch of diseased muskrats coming out of that beard. He adored Julia. There's no way that she was going to condone this. When Grant arrived, Grant is the consummate optimist. I don't think I've ever, in working on historical characters, encountered somebody who was so incurably optimistic. And he's a natural-born entrepreneur. With the ship carrying him and part of his regiment coming up from Panama, when they landed near Benicia, essentially puts the L.A. area now, the first thing he does is write a letter back to Julia saying, I have seen this country. There's something to be made here. Fortunes can be made here. He's talking about, you know, Pasadena and Los Angeles and all this other stuff. He said, we might just move out here. I think a man can make something of himself in California. And he proceeds to try to do it. Then he gets transferred to Oregon. So he sets out once again. He says, well, Oregon's pretty nice too. And all these immigrants are coming on the Oregon Trail, and they're landing out at the Dalles or the Dales, I don't know how it's pronounced, out on the Columbia River, and they're tired, and they're hungry. Their draft animals are exhausted. Their livestock is exhausted. If I grew vegetables and produce, I could sell it to those people here. If I raise fresh horses and fresh beeves, I can exchange them for their worn-out animals and make a profit in the offing. Grant was setting up a fully vertical, integrated corporation controlling everything from supply through demand and fulfillment to demand. He was a corporate thinker, but it failed, A, because of a flood, and B, because he got transferred someplace again. The army tended to get in his way. So yes, Grant didn't succeed out there, but it's not for fecklessness or foolishness, as the myth would have it. It's just chance. But then looking at these two men together, what struck me most of all is not how unlike they are, but how similar they are. Time after time, when you look at what they do, you find them doing almost identically the same thing in situations that are comparable. At Shiloh and at Chancellorsville, both men are taken by surprise at first. And how do they deal with it? Not by retreating, but by looking at the ground, deciding where they will stand, deciding what it's going to take to get themselves out of that situation, and going forward. And both do it, and both win. At Fort Donelson and at Spotsylvania, both are surprised by the weight of an enemy attack on one aspect of their line. But what they immediately think is, if the enemy was strong enough to hit me with that force here, he had to weaken himself somewhere else. So my response will be to attack there. And both are successful. Both will divide their armies in the face of the foe to strike a decisive blow. Lee at 2nd Manassas in Chancellorsville. Grant at Iuka in Vicksburg. The myth is that Lee was a virtually undefeated genius, only overpowered by superior numbers and resources, while Grant was a plodding butcher who only won by overwhelming power. In fact, in many respects, their skills and their generalship are virtually identical. There are some differences. Lee had the unwavering support of Jefferson Davis and a wonderful working relationship with him, a relationship that's responsible to Lee, because Lee knew how to work with a difficult superior. Grant had never met Lincoln until early 1864, and in fact, prior to that time, Lincoln was a little suspicious of Grant because he was so successful. He's the Union's first real battlefield hero and the leading one by 1864. Lincoln has some fears that Grant might have some interest in challenging him for the Republican nomination for the presidency. It's only after Grant makes it clear he has no presidential ambition in 1864 that Lincoln goes ahead and brings him east, and eventually, of course, will put him in charge of all of the armies. Grant has to deal with constant political infighting in his rear from these political generals I just mentioned to you. Lee is very fortunate that he has almost none of that to deal with. He doesn't have a great working relationship with a few people, but no one's really working against him behind the lines, not even Longstreet, who's interested in getting an independent command, but he's not interested in undercutting Lee. From 1861 onward, Lee reports directly to Davis, but Grant will report first to John C. Fremont, then Henry Halleck, then George McClellan. What a trio of aces. And then to Halleck again. It's really only in 1863 that Grant begins to get some real freedom. Lee has some substantial and significant advantages to help offset Grant's superiority in numbers and materiel. The differences between the men physically are profound. And there you see some differences that help to explain some of their performance. In 1864, Lee is 57, which I used to think sounded pretty old. These pants are more than 57 years old. You can tell by the out-of-date pleats. His physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual health are all in decline. He has a heart ailment. He's tired. He complains of lack of energy, that he can't concentrate, that he has trouble seeing. The war, both physically but also emotionally, has exhausted him. Mentally, he's older than his years. His marriage was always difficult and got more difficult as the years went on. He views himself, as he freely confesses in his letters, as a failure, as a father, as a husband, and as a man. He has little or no enthusiasm for anything. Spiritually, he is a providentialist by this time, viewing man and himself as completely helpless, having no control over his life, completely subject to the whim of the Almighty. The notion essentially is you simply go from one suffering to another until finally you have the good fortune to die, and then you go to heaven. It's not a real uplifting outlook. Grant, by contrast, is 42. He is in the best health of his life. He's 15 years younger. He has a magnificent marriage. He's an incurable optimist. He always expects to win. He believes that a man makes his own luck, and he does. He always expects to succeed. Grant, as I mentioned already, will deal directly and decisively with conflict. He has no trouble firing people. He has no trouble arresting people. He really, I think, doesn't entirely understand why someone would react negatively to being criticized or told they had not been performing well. They should just take it and get on and do their job. He arrests people. Lee will avoid confrontation at almost all costs. If he has an officer in his command, Daniel H. Hill comes to mind, with whom he's not getting along, he doesn't confront the problem directly. He gets Richmond to assign that officer someplace else. So has Lee solved the problem? He's just made it somebody else's problem. Grant is perhaps too optimistic at times. Sometimes he doesn't prepare carefully enough because he expects to win. Neither has any use for councils of war. They will solicit the opinions of their subordinates on operations, and they listen if a subordinate proposes an idea, as when Grant will accept George Thomas's plan for opening the so-called cracker line to relieve Chattanooga. But at the end of the day, when a decision has to be made, they do not seek consensus. They don't look for the comfort or security of a majority opinion. They make their decisions themselves. Both know how to adapt to the unexpected. Both armies in this conflict, all armies in all conflicts, are rife with generals who, confronted by the unexpected, taken by surprise, immediately turn around and retreat to regroup and think about what to do next. As I mentioned, my late grandfather was career military. He was in the quartermaster corps, he never commanded men in combat. But he did once say there are two kinds of generals. There are those who are surprised, and there are those who lie. Every general suffers a surprise or an unexpected setback. How do Lee and Grant respond to these? Identically. Essentially to say, I didn't expect that. This isn't good. How do I turn this to my advantage? The thought is always on seizing the initiative and taking it back to the foe. Both are good at delegation. You hear a lot of criticism of Lee for not being good at delegation. He's less good at it, let's say, than Grant, but neither is a micromanager. Arguably, Grant may give better orders because they're so succinct and concise. It's no surprise that Grant's post-war memoirs are still regarded as perhaps the finest memoir ever written by an American. He was a master of saying a lot in a few words. Lee could get kind of wordy sometimes, and that could lead to some confusion. Lee's a better disciplinarian than Grant. Both set model personal examples. They consciously try to appear not to hold themselves above their men. It's easier for Grant because he's cut from the same cloth as most of his soldiers. Lee is a patrician, a Lee of Virginia, who constantly, I think, has to remind himself not to behave like a man of his class, but to present himself as not just one of the bubbas out in the field, but to make sure that he's seen as accessible. Both will take colossal risks. Lee at Second Manassas and Antietam, another defeat that is really a victory. Grant in Vicksburg and elsewhere. Both will make the big decision. They can risk everything and then go to bed and get a good night's sleep. Think of Harry Truman, the night before the 1948 election. Truman, the night before the bombs are dropped, going to bed with all that responsibility, and good old Harry gets a good night's sleep. He's from Independence, Missouri, my hometown, so I understand these things. They had failures at personnel management. Every general does. Lee never made Longstreet as useful as he would have liked. Grant failed with George Thomas. Both do have their failures. Both will be criticized for their losses. Both men instinctively understood and respected the role of the military as subordinate to the civil authority in a democracy, something George B. McClellan never understood, something Douglas MacArthur never understood, something the recent General McChrystal still doesn't understand. They are subordinates to the civil authority. Never will either one of them challenge that civil authority. And evidently, neither has any ego to get in the way. This is a wonderful thing in a general. I mean, you go to the Oxford English Dictionary, look up the word general, and it will give you a cross-reference. See ego. See also fathead. There is no ego in operation. At the end of the day, what did these men think of each other? Interestingly, after the war, Grant said of Lee that, I'm quoting, he was of a slow, conservative, cautious nature, without imagination or humor, always the same, with grave dignity. There's a compliment in there, but it's somewhat reserved. Unable or unwilling to see that Lee's achievements justified his reputation, Grant concluded with a phrase I love and will never completely understand when he said, Lee is a man who needed sunshine. Grant will say the only Confederate general he was ever really afraid of with Joseph E. Johnston, the Confederate McClellan. For his part, Lee rated Grant as a pedestrian commander who only succeeded because of raw numbers, the essence of the Lost Cause myth. And more than once, Lee, in fact, will say that the best general he faced in the war was George B. McClellan, the Union's Joseph E. Johnston. In the end, neither Grant nor Lee could or would admit that the other was his preeminent adversary. They were both eminently human. Thank you all for listening. We've got, I guess, about 10 or 15 minutes for questions, if there are any. Or comments, either one. I don't want anything from him.
I'll give you an easy one. Jack, can you comment on the circumstances of Grant's resignation from the Army in, what was it, 1856? You're saying there was no drinking involved in that?
The question deals with the circumstances of Grant's resignation from the Army in, is it 1856? I've forgotten, or 55. I think it's 55. He writes regularly to Julia, fortunately. But there is a long gap in their letters, and sometimes he'll go months without getting a letter from her. Grant, as I mentioned earlier, is always a bit at sea when he's not near Julia. His career's going okay. He's gotten a promotion to captain at the glacial pace in which a promotion took place in the old Army. In fact, Grant has advanced slightly faster than Lee had, at least to the rank of captain. He's stuck in Humboldt, in Northern California, which is one of the most isolated posts there is for the old front, for the old pre-war Army. It's probably depressing. It is possible, certainly, that Grant started drinking there. We don't know. One of the stories is that he was told to resign by his colonel, Colonel Buchanan, or it would be exposed that Grant had become a drunkard and he'd be kicked out of the Army. There's no source or support for that, whatever. There is no contemporary source, whatever, that Grant was drinking, though he may have. There are a number of stories that Grant was drinking at that time that came out in 1898 and 99 after a man named Hamlin Garland put together a biography of Grant in which he solicited recollections from a lot of people who'd known him. And this is already after the Grant the Drunkard story has been out there in the press constantly for more than 30 years. And I suspect some of these old guys just kind of incorporated some of that into their recollections, saying Grant was a drinker in California. The short form answer is we don't know why. The only thing I can attribute it to is he was depressed being in this awful backwater. I mean, Humboldt County today, it's where all the dope is grown in California. I grew up a little south of there. I still remember. And that he missed Julia. If there's more to that, we simply don't have sources to tell us. There's one over there.
Hi. I was curious about in 1864 when Grant takes over, he keeps George Gordon Meade on as the commander of the Army of the Potomac. Did he give him any real independent discretion, or was he just constantly looking over his shoulder, telling him what to do? And if so, why do you think that was the case?
When Grant comes east as general-in-chief, he does, in fact, keep Meade in place as a commandant of the Army of the Potomac. Grant has a lot of respect for Meade. Meade never really fully understands how well Grant thought of him. So, unfortunately, Meade will go to his grave thinking Grant was really never behind him, when Grant, in fact, had done a lot to try to get Meade a promotion in the regular Army to the full grade rank of Major General and some other things like that. Meade does have a great deal of discretion, but Grant will set the overall, strategic pattern. And from time to time, Grant will make ersatz decisions, spot decisions on the battlefield, which is never good because it can tend to undermine the self-confidence of a subordinate. But Meade is given a lot more operational independence than has commonly been accepted, I think. Right behind you, this one.
Can you comment on Elizabeth Warren's thesis that Grant and Lee left Appomattox with different ideas of what surrender meant?
Yeah. Elizabeth Warren's book is called Appomattox, and there's a subtitle. I've forgotten what it is. It's a very thought-provoking book, and I think a good one. Essentially is that they went to Appomattox with different expectations and came away with different expectations. It's not generally known or appreciated that Lee essentially thinks he's negotiating at Appomattox. Indeed, if you read their correspondence over the 2 days previous, when Grant sends Lee a note saying, surely it's time, you must recognize it's hopeless to hold out longer, let's talk about surrender. And Lee will say, we've not yet reached the point at which I need to consider the surrender of my army, but just for the fun of it, what would your terms be? And then Grant says immediately an immediate unconditional surrender. And Lee, in a response to that, says, refers to the Confederate state forces under my command. He's not talking about the Army of Northern Virginia. He's talking about all Confederate Army forces everywhere because he is now General-in-Chief. He's hinting at a negotiation. We may be beaten, but even if my army has to surrender, there's still more than 100,000 Confederate soldiers under arms under Kirby Smith and Dick Taylor and Joe Shelby from Tennessee all the way to Texas. You might have to defeat us in detail, but we can cost you a great deal of blood and treasure to defeat us that way. In return for lenient terms, I might be able to surrender all of them. This is nothing new. Lee was actually taking part in discussions with Senator R.M.T. Hunter of Virginia, Secretary of War John C. Breckinridge, Senator George Vest of Missouri, and others in Richmond in January and February of 1865, in which they were discussing what kind of proposed honorable peace could they present or try to maneuver Jefferson Davis into going along with in return for them laying down their arms in return for restoration of full rights of citizenship, no show trials, no war crime trials, no confiscation of personal property, allowing the seceded states to go back into the Union with no stipulations. Slavery's dead. They understand slavery is dead. They understand secession and the Confederacy are dead. But there's a whole lot of other stuff they still think they can negotiate for. Civil order has completely broken down in the Confederacy because all the men are away. The jail bars have been melted down to make guns. But if the Confederate soldiers are not disarmed, if they're allowed to go home as organized units, they can be civil peacekeeping forces in their communities until it's possible for time and elections to reconstitute civil authorities. They can prevent pandemonium or anarchy, they think, by this sort of Confederate version of Reconstruction. Lee takes part in all those discussions and at one point appears to be willing to go along with him. Then he backs out and we don't know for sure why. But Lee is still hoping for something like that after Appomattox. Lee and Grant meet again on April 10th. Nobody left a good account. They sit on their horses and they talk for about half an hour, but it's pretty clear from the little bit we do have that Grant wants to go the next step and persuade Lee to surrender universally, all Confederate military forces, not naval, of course. But Lee backs away from it. And again, we don't know exactly why. But Lee's hoping for a very minimal readjustment back into the Union. Grant leaves Appomattox, I think, expecting that the war is over, the resistance is over, and that they are now going to acquiesce in this rather than be essentially kind of grudging and resistant for the next few years. Is that time up? Thank you all very much.